the terrazza. Please come because you may regret 20 years from now that you are not in this picture. And for those who are staying in Trieste, I wanted to make you aware that there is a boat which goes from the bus stop to Trieste, stopping in Barcola, takes 40 minutes. Beautiful ride, so I highly recommend. From Trieste, it starts at 8 in the morning. We arrive here at 8:40, so just in time for the lecture. Okay, and our first speaker is Alberto. We'll continue his lecture on localization and ABS black holes and
okay, so in most of these lectures, we will focus on a particular example, which is a black hole in ADS4, magnetically charged and static. Yesterday, I mentioned the difference between magnetic charges and electric charges is pretty relevant. So at the moment, the only computation that complete computation that exists for that matches the localization computation that matches the black hole entropy can be done for magnetically charged black hole. We will come back to this point later during the lecture. As already mentioned yesterday, the magnetic charge perform a topological twist in the field theory. That's the reason why, that's the reason of the difference between different type of black hole, and I don't know if it is by coincidence or for some deep reason, when there is a topological twist, the field theory computation, even if it is the wrong one, is an index, not an entropy, gives the right result. Okay, so let me say what kind of black hole we'll be considering. Black hole that are asymptotic to ADS4, dionic, so there will be both electric and magnetic charges, no rotation, so static. Static for simplicity, you can introduce rotation in this black hole. The field theory computation has never been done because it's technically complicated, but the matrix model that I'll show you can be generalized to include rotation, and I don't expect any news there. It's just a technical problem of taking the larger limit of the black hole. But I will consider the static case. The other requirement is that this black hole can be embedded in ADS4 times S7. The reason we mentioned yesterday is the following. I know the dual. That's the maximally supersymmetric background is dual to a maximally supersymmetric field theory in 3D, which is the ABJM model. So from the point of view of the black hole, it's useful to not to consider the full M theory on ADS4 times S7, but to perform a dimensional reduction to 4D. And luckily enough, there is such dimensional reduction. It's even in the form of a consistent truncation, which means that the solution of the equation of motion that you find in 4D can be uplifted to 10D. It's not always the case, but in this case, we are lucky enough, so there is a consistent truncation that contains precisely the field I'm interested in, and I remember you that I want electric no charge in ADS4, the black hole is static, so there is no rotation, but the black hole is electrically charged, so from the point of view of 11-dimensional theory, is, if you want, is spinning inside a 7, so the electric charges will be charges under the Cartan of the isometry group of S7, which is SO8. So I need 4 vectors. And the dimensional reduction gives you an n equal to 2 gauge supergravity, as discussed by Stefan in his lecture, with 3 vector multiplet. Why 3 and not 4, because remember that in the gravity multiplet of n equal to 2 supergravity, there is already a vector. And indeed, the matter content can be summarized, the bosonic matter content, the relevant bosonic matter content can be summarized in this way. There is a gravity multiplet that contains the metric and the graviphoton. And then there are three guys here, three vector multiplets. Each contain a vector field, scalars, and fermions. I goes from 1 to 3. So NV, number of vector multiplet, is 3. Combining the three-gauge field with the graviphoton, you can fill the four vectors that you need in the dimensional reduction. Graviphoton is, in some sense, associated with the R-symmetry of the dual conformal field theory. So as Stefan discussed in a very efficient way in the last two lectures, it is in writing the gauge supergravity, it's convenient to combine the vectors in a guy with an index lambda that goes from 1 to 4 or 0 to 3. 0 is more typical in the supergravity literature. And in a sense, 0 corresponds to the graviphoton, and 1, 2, and 3 correspond to the vector fields in the vector multiplet. And these four guys give the Cartan of U1 to the fourth. Now, this dimensional truncation has been studied in the literature. So people have written the effective Lagrangian, in n equal to 2 formalism. Read all the details. Remember that Stefan told you that you need to essentially to specify completely the model, you need to give a prepotential, which is a function of holomorphic section. So you may think that the physical scalar fields here, there are three, can be written in terms of this holomorphic section as ratios, okay? So in a sense, the holomorphic section are like projective coordinates for your manifold of scalars. There are four guys here, same number as the vectors, but only three are independent. One way of fixing the physical scalar is just to take the ratio. It's not the only one. You can take any possible parametrization that you want. The Lagrangian will be invariant under a rescaling of this section X, so and then you just get 3 degrees of freedom. Complex degrees of freedom. The scalars are complex. So you need to specify the prepotential, and since there is no matter, the only thing that you need to give here is this set of Fayet-Lyopoulos coupling, which are just the guys that enters in the potential. There is a potential. Essentially, they specify how you are gauging the field, the gravitino, actually. The only thing gauged here is the gravitino. So there are coupling constant for, these are coupling constant for the four U1s. These guys, as Stefan mentioned, are called magnetic Fayet-Lyopoulos. They will play no role in, luckily enough, no role in this lecture, because then things become more complicated and nasty. So we will only, in this truncation, luckily enough, you can just use electric charge. Well, better for those that knows a little bit about symplectic transformation, there is a frame where you can always, which is also a natural one, where you can just use electric Fayet-Lyopoulos. And indeed, this data has been written, and you can search the literature, and you will find that the prepotential is this square root that already appeared in Stefan lecture. The four guys here, the electric Fayet-Lyopoulos, are all equal. They'll call the common value G, equal because there is SO8 in the original theory. So it's essentially the four vector can be rotated by the SO8 symmetry, even if I break it to the Cartan. And as I was mentioning, luckily enough, there are no magnetic magnetic phi A Lyopoulos. Let me check if I put the index. Kirill, help me. I think the standard notation is index down for the electric and index up for the magnetic. Yes, I think, yeah. Okay. So let me briefly comment about this prepotential. Stefan mentioned that typically when you do in flat space compactification on Calabiau, you get the cubic prepotential. In this case, it would be x1, x2, x3 divided x0. That's very typical, also because the cubic structure comes from some intersection of cycle in Calabiaus and so on. Here you may think, okay, there is no Calabiau because it's S7, it's a different structure. But actually, if you look at how the truncation is done, if you naive perform the truncation on S7, in the typical frame that you get with standard parametrization of fields in 10 dimensions, you will get a prepotential which is the cubic one. But you will get also a bunch of tensors in 4 dimension. Tensors in 4 dimension are dual to scalars, so it's better to work with scalars and not with tensors. So typically in the reduction you get the cubic and tensor. Then you do one of these electric magnetic duality, symplectic transformation. The symplectic transformation maps the cubic prepotential in the square root. The tensor becomes dualized to a scalar, and you have a better picture of the story. So this is roughly how it works from the point of view of truncation. So this is the model. Now, Stefan showed you an explicit solution of this model with magnetic charges when x1 was set equal to x2 and x3. Well, actually, there is a full family of dionic black hole in this model. That the first one was found by Cacciatore Clem, then Stefan and Kirill wrote a paper, also Dall'Agatagnecchi have an important one, and more recently, after the work of Katmadas and Almagi that completely filled all the gaps, now there is a full family of black hole depending on electric and magnetic charges. So these black holes, this black hole have a metric that I'm not sure I'm using the same notation as Stefan, certainly not the same signature, but okay, we will never have problem about it. But when you check literature, remember, one of typical confusion is everyone is using different type of signature, different use for the letter. There are always common letters, U and V, but everyone uses it in a different way, so be careful. And so the metric is this one. Here I was, as I was mentioning yesterday, all these black holes exist in many different ways, in many different forms. So there are the spherically symmetric ones, where the horizon is a sphere. Okay, this is the nice black hole. But you can replace the sphere with an arbitrary Riemann surface of arbitrary genus. There is no much difference. So we'll do a computation, I will fix on S2 because I can write explicitly everything. In principle, everything can be done for a Riemann surface. I will tell you the details. And so dionic means that they have charges, electric and magnetic charges. So the magnetic charges appear in this way. So there is an horizon here. And if you integrate your gauge field on the horizon, you will get essentially some integer. This is like the monopole I was discussing yesterday. Dirac quantization condition tells you that you should get an integer. Obviously, it depends on normalization and other things. So typically, you write in this form. And then I will tell you how the quantization works. So these are, for the moment, are not necessarily integer. That's the standard notation in gauge supergravity. There is a factor of the volume just for normalization, and then there is P, which is the magnetic charge, okay? In some units, this P will become an integer. And these are just the magnetic charges. What are electric charges? Well, electric charges, you can, this gauge field on a sphere is roughly something that has component on theta and phi and is proportional to P lambda sin theta. Okay, that's the idea on a sphere, on a stone. An electric field instead has components along the radial direction and time, and a covariant way of writing an electric charge is the following. You define this guy here. Let me try to put consistently index up and down. We will not really need it, but this up and down of the index has not been completely discussed in this lecture, but has to do with this symplectic transformation. So if you want to keep a formalism which is invariant under electric and magnetic duality, you need to keep track of the position of the index. We will not need it, but I'll try to be as much consistent as I can. So you, essentially, you define this, which is just the derivative of the, your Lagrangian with respect to the curvature, and it's a sort of dual field. So this is roughly the star of this guy. Okay, the idea is that G is roughly the star of F. So this measure electric charges. You take the dual, you integrate over the same cycle, okay, and you will get another number, which is now the electric charge. So again, the factor of the volume and Q lambda, and this is the electric, okay? Explicit in component, you may think that this is a gauge field that has legs along the radial coordinate and time direction, okay? So these are the guys. Now, in principle, you can introduce four of this and four of this because you have four gauge fields. But actually, supersymmetry tells you that there are constraints. One is particularly important, is a linear constraint on the magnetic charges, and is related to the topological twist that I was mentioning yesterday. So, constraints. The first one, written in full generality, okay, for a model where you also have magnetic gaugings, would be something like this. This combination, and when you put the index in the correct way, you get something that is symplectic invariant, so it's the same in all possible frames. This should be essentially quantized. In the units that I'm using, you introduce this object that is typical in supergravity, in black hole literature. You introduce a number that distinguishes between the sphere, is one for the sphere, is zero for the torus, and is minus one for a Riemann surface of genus strictly greater than one. So essentially it's telling you if the curvature is positive, is a sort of normalized curvature, positive for the sphere, zero for the torus, and negative for the Higher genus Riemann surface that can be always constructed as the hyperbolic plane divided a discrete subgroup. So you see that this particular combination is should be fixed. For our black hole, there is no magnetic gauging, and you get an equation that tells you essentially that since also all the G's are equal, I call it all of them with the same letter G, this equation tells you that the sum of the magnetic charges is minus this K divided by G. Okay, so it's fixed. The sum of the magnetic charges is fixed. What's the physical meaning of this? Well, this is the way supersymmetry is preserved, I was mentioning yesterday, and from the point of view of physics, of the dual field theory, is the topological twist condition. So it's the condition that tells you that the variation of the gravitino, which is roughly of this form, yes. Well, let me put also the correctly, there is an index. There are two gravitinos, so there is an index here. And the correct version of this equation is something like this, delta AB epsilon BC epsilon C, where this epsilon is the antisymmetric tensor in two dimension, and the other epsilon is the spin of supersymmetry, you know? Okay? So essentially it's spin connection and A mu that couples to the epsilon, so probably I should put an I here because, yes, I should put an I here. Okay, and probably in the notation that I'll be using tomorrow, the plus here. Okay, so what's the logic of this? Well, you see that the gauge field has a profile for the magnetic charge part, which is given by the P's. So here you will find the P's. So you will find a background monopole here that is proportional to P. This is G. So you get precisely this combination here. G times P is the coefficient here. And the trick that we were using yesterday, and this is how supersymmetry is realized, is telling you that this guy cancels precisely the spin connection on the Riemann surface, okay? So the condition that supersymmetry is realized with a constant spinor is precisely this linear condition on the magnetic charges. So you have four gauge fields, a linear combination corresponding in a sense to the R symmetry of the field theory, and this is fixed. Okay? Only the sum, okay? Then you have three other P's, three independent P, and you can play with those guys, okay?
This
A mu is not globally well defined.
By patches and...
Yes, also the spin connection.
So does it make a problem to cancel? Or?
No, you may think that your epsilon is a section of a line bundle on the Riemann surface. A mu is a gauge field on another line bundle. And you choose the line bundle that cancels the other one.
But don't you get like different epsilons for different functions?
But also epsilon is a spinor, so it's a section of a bundle. Everything is a section of the bundle, OK? So this is in a local chart, so makes sense globally. Just think as epsilon is a section of the spin bundle. It's a line bundle on the sphere or Riemann surface. Then you twist with the U1 bundle associated with the gauge field, and you choose the bundle that cancel the spin bundle. And then you get a constant. But everything is written in a particular set of coordinates. And if you want to change the frame or change set of coordinates, everything transforms in a consistent way. Okay, so this constraint leaves three independent magnetic charges, and the physical meaning is the twisting condition. Yes?
So these are integers, right?
Oh, in some units they are integers. I will tell you in which units in a moment. Yes, they are proportional to integer with some factor depending on the curvature. They are not yet the integer, but yes. Both P and Q should be in some lattice because of Dirac quantization condition.
Is this condition an integer condition or is it large?
Say it again.
Is this condition, is the right-hand side an integer or something? In the same unit?
In the same units, the right-hand side is an integer. Yes, I'll show you in next formula. Luckily enough, I wrote the right formula, and it is an integer. Okay, I'll come back to this question in a second.
The electric potential appears
or not?
The
electric
charges?
Twisting condition. So this one was a simplified version of the BPS equation. The electric potential enters, I think, when you try to solve the equation of motion for the black hole for arbitrary value of the radial coordinate. Then this epsilon, I should say more precisely, when I say epsilon is constant on the Riemann surface, in general, or at the horizon, if you want. When you try to solve the equation for the BPS equation, you will find a radial profile for this spinor, and in the equation for the radial profile, you will find the contribution of the electric part of the gauge field. It's only on the sphere and Riemann surface, yes. Yes. Sorry, I should have said more precisely. Oh, the second one is curious. I don't know why there is such a constraint, but there is. Well, I know why there is, but it's curious, as I was mentioning yesterday. There is also an ugly nonlinear constraint. I'm not trying to write it. It's in Almaggi paper. You need some quartic invariant of gauge supergravity to write it in full glory. But there is a nonlinear constraint among the charges. I will tell you in a moment where it comes from. And also this. This constraint, if you want, you can may think that this constraint one electric charge. Okay? So the total number of independent charges is 3 magnetic plus 3 electric. This is the set of parameters the black hole depends on. And these charges are quantized. And let me write the quantization condition so that you can check that this equation is consistent with p being an integer, and the quantization condition you can work it out. Okay, I'm not doing this. It's not difficult, but okay, it takes takes some time in fixing properly notations and everything, and is essentially this one. So for all possible, these index now are not sum over. So you need to take this equation for each set of indices. And you will get this Dirac quantization condition. So where eta is, again, is quite standard in the literature, is this combination associated with the genus. So it's an integer. This is for g different from 1. And for g equal 1, this is just 1, okay? You need to separate the case of a torus. So I think now, if you plug it here, you will discover that this is consistent with this condition here. Say it. Oh, no, one of the two is q, sorry. The denominator is g, the Faye-Heliopoulos, and here you have the electric charge. Ooh, good question. Let me think. I don't think so. I'll write a formula and tell you how it comes from. Looking at the formula, I think no, probably not. It's not the, in this formula, there is an overall factor of G, but it doesn't affect the constraint. Okay, so Stefan told you about the attractor mechanism. So the scalar fields are fixed at the horizon as function of the charges. And luckily enough, for this class of black hole, there is a very simple way of writing these attractor equations. Oh, yes, in principle, well, no, actually, when I say that there are 3 plus 3 independent parameter is not that for all integer there is a black hole. Now I will write a formula for the entropy. For those integer values such that the entropy is real and positive, you have a black hole. Otherwise, but the full conditions are very complicated, so you need to check. Roughly, there are 3 parameter plus 3 that you can vary, but if you choose randomly set of integer, maybe your black hole is not there because the entropy is negative or not real.
Yeah, but should this constraint be part of a saddle point and valid only for large charges, or is it valid also for small charges?
Hey, this is supergravity, so no, well, no, I think here the charges can be 1, 2, 3, there is already the cosmological constant that makes the black hole macroscopic. So no, I think in the supergravity limit, you are not thinking that the integer are large. Okay, the integer that appear in the quantization condition can be 1, 2, 3, 4, both the electric and magnetic one.
But can such integers satisfy this non-linear constraint?
You mean if there are, you can find integer solution or just approximated one? Good question. So for when you turn off the electric charge, for sure, when you turn on the electric charges, you may have constraints, also coming from the fact that you have a nonlinear constraint that, and you need to find integer solution. Then probably the point that if you well, if you take the charge big enough, it's a good approximation. Okay. Okay. So, so luckily enough, this attractor equation has been written quite explicitly. And they are also very simple to write. This, I think, has been done by Dallagat and Gnecchi. Well, the same equation has been written by Stefan and Kirill. And but in this notation that you, for example, find in the paper of Dallagat and Gnecchi, you can define a particular function of the scalar fields. Remember that the scalar, everything is fixed in terms of a prepotential, which depends on this section, which parameterizes the scalar field. So don't trust me completely with sine, i's, and so on. If one day you need to do a computation, please check all conventions. I'm not completely sure that the i is correct, but so sorry, this is Q, this is J instead. So the denominator depends on the phi Heliopoulos, the numerator depends on the charges, and this pair here is given by the scalars, and this F lambda has been used also by Stefan, is the first derivative of the prepotential. So if you have F, you construct this object here, it's a very simple object. And the point is that in order to get the value of the scalar fields at the horizon, you just need to extremize this quantity. It's a very simple, not algebraic, but simple function of the scalar fields, and you need to find the solution of this this equation. You need to extremize. Fine. Okay. Why is that? Okay. You need to do a computation. It's nothing particularly deep. It follows from the BPS equation. You repackage in a nice way, and you use a little bit of special geometry, and you find that you can repackage in this way. Just BPS equation. Okay. You look at the horizon, and they become essentially not algebraic, but a set of equations for the value of the scalar fields. The point is that typically BPS equation contains derivative of the scalar, but at the horizon you set the derivative to zero. The gauge fields are pretty simple at the horizon, and everything works out nicely. And attractor means you need to extremize this quantity, engage supergravity with only vector multiplet. And the value will give you the scalar fields at the horizon, but not only. It also will give you the entropy of the black hole, because part of this game is that the same quantity determines the entropy, which is a function of the magnetic and electric charges. And the formula is pretty simple. There is some factor of Newton constant, the volume of the Riemann surface. But basically, you just take the function, you extremize, the value of the function is the entropy in suitable units. Okay?
Sorry.
Yes?
Is this related in any way to the entropy function that Semir introduced
yesterday? The Sen entropy function? Well,
practically,
yes, depends. But the mapping is non-trivial. So the same extremization gives you.
You still have an ADS2 in the near
horizon. Yes, yes. I think there are papers where all these things are compared. You should ask Kirill, he knows. but not immediately. So these are different coordinates, so slightly different way of repackaging the same information. Okay, in the supersymmetric way, I expect that a sine entropy function. Well, I expect. I'm pretty sure some entropy function is the same as this. Should be. Yes, but the question of motion.
The same minimization and the same extremum, then the two functions must be the same.
That's right. But you're minimizing with
yes.
different things. So for in particular, the sections are not really nice scalars.
Yes, depends how you, yeah. So there should be a non trivial mapping between. OK. So there is a caveat here that has to do with the second constraint. Where this come from? Well, if you try to extremize this, typically you will get complex solution for the x. The x are complex scalar. You plug it back. It's not obvious that the result is real. The entropy should be real. So in addition to the extremization, you have an extra condition that is essentially the following. The result that you find at the end should be real. This is an extra condition that comes from BPS, if you want, makes the black hole regular. And if you look at the details, you discover that this second condition is equivalent to this constraint on the charges. So this constraint on the charges is just a constraint that tells you that this extremization gives a real value for the real positive value for the entropy. And second remark is the following. This is written in terms of holomorphic section. They are not independent objects. In principle, you can parameterize in terms of scalar fields, so the ratio, if you want. But it's not strictly necessary. When you have this equation, you can just take the derivative with respect to x. You may say, OK, there is one more x. So hopefully, one equation is linearly dependent on the other. And this is the case because you can check easily, since f is homogeneous of degree 2, that the numerator and denominator are homogeneous of degree 1. So the function is homogeneous of degree 0. So the four derivatives with respect to the x are related one to the other. So if you satisfy three of them, the fourth is automatically satisfied. So you don't even need to put an explicit parametrization for the scalar field. You just take derivative with respect to the sections. And the explicit expression for the entropy can be written, but it's quite complicated. Let me write in a simple example just to show you that it's not so simple as asymptotically flat black hole in the supergravity regime. The Waffast Strominger black hole has a pretty boring entropy, square root of the product of three charges. Here is not. If you take, for example, three independent charges, magnetic charges equal, let's call it P, so that the fourth is given by minus 1 over G, on the sphere, on S2, minus 1 over G minus 3P, and zero electric charges, so the simplest possible case, just one parameter, the entropy is proportional to this quantity here. And this is the point where the Tratton mechanism is interesting and useful in comparison with field theory, because if you do a field theory computation, you get a result. Then you need to check that your result is this one, which can be very complicated for the black hole with three magnetic charges and three electric charges. Luckily enough, this is how we did first, so brute force. But luckily enough, the Tratton mechanism, we will see that the Tratton mechanism contains precisely the same information as field theory. So you can just look at the Tratton mechanism without explicitly computing the entropy, which is in general is a mess. Last remark before starting with the field theory part is the following, has been already made by Stefan, but it's important conceptually also for the field theory part. So this black hole well, for large radial coordinate, they behaves as ADS. So for example, for the spherically symmetric, for all of these guys, the boundary metric for R very large is of ADS form. This is the boundary times the Riemann surface, there is the radial coordinate. There is also an horizon, and near the horizon, the asymptotic is the usual one for supersymmetric black hole. So there are, in the full expression, there are functions that depends on R. So this, the same function goes like 1 over R squared for large R, and there is a zero for at some finite value. The time component is similar. And then up to constant here, I'm not very careful with the constant. The function that multiply this space become constant at the horizon. So that here you can recognize another ADS, this time ADS2. And the horizon metric is ADS2 times the Riemann surface. So this somehow suggests, in the language of holography, a renormalization flow. So whenever you see a solution interpolating between two different ADS, you say in field theory there is some renormalization flow that is going on. In this case, is a renormalization flow between manifold of different dimensions, ADS4 and ADS2. But you start with a three-dimensional theory. You put the three-dimensional theory on a Riemann surface, so you are actually compactifying it. And this reduces the three-dimensional theory to a quantum mechanics. So the quantum mechanics, if at some limit the quantum mechanics become conformal, super conformal, it will reproduce for you a factor of ADS2. So if you want, from this point of view of the bulk, you can also interpret the black hole as a renormalization group flow that tells you that this compactified three-dimensional theory flows in the infrared, in some sense, in the limit of large time. I'm always confused what's the meaning of renormalization group flow in quantum mechanics, but say that in the limit of large time, correlation function behaves like conformal correlation function in some superconformal field theory, at least. This is the expectation of the holographic picture, and in the language that we were using yesterday, counting states, at this point, it's clear what I'm counting. There is a quantum mechanics, there will be a set of ground states. I need to count the set of ground states of this quantum mechanics. And here is where I can use localization. So let's go in the last 15 minutes to the, let's start the field theory part. We go back to localization. So the point is that I have a three-dimensional field theory. Yes. Yes.
So do you expect your quantum mechanics to be, just to say something, in the same class of SYK type?
Or? Oh, I have no idea. I will show you a formula for the index. It's a mess. Depends on many different sector, topological sector on the compactification space. I don't actually know. I would like to know what kind of quantum mechanics is here. So there are many superconformal quantum mechanics. Is not well understood. In particular, ADS2 CFT1 is not well understood. I expect that is a, well.
For example, if I take just ABGN, twist it, and I reduce on S2, you think this is the theory?
This is the theory. In some limit, there should be some superconformal quantum mechanics. Maybe just in the larger limit. It could be that is in the larger limit. When you go to finite N, you have a picture like XY, what's the name? SYK, SYK, with a gap. So what I will do is essentially, the idea is that I don't know what is the superconformal quantum mechanics. Could have a lot of flat direction as a quantum mechanism because it's conformal, like typically they have. I will regularize it in a particular way. I will count the index of the regularized quantum mechanics, and then I will take the limit where the regulator goes to zero. What exactly this quantum mechanics here and what form it has is not clear. In this entropy functional, Sen has the idea that these quantum mechanics are very special because they are they have just a bunch of ground states and then a gap. This could be the case. I honestly, I don't know because I have no control on what exactly is this quantum mechanics.
I was just
could happen in the case, right? Because there should be a gap. Are you imagining that?
I don't know. Honestly, I don't know. I could imagine that, given this picture of SYK, I could also expect something more, some funny limit of models with gaps.
Therefore, it's probably not like SYK. It's really, there's a gap and it's a finite, it's a trivial
No, but there could be a limit where the this gap goes to zero. I think in some of these melonic models, I saw similar things. There are parameters, then at a certain point you can send to zero. You don't know what they are doing, and you don't send it in this melonic model. But
since sigma g, and what I'm saying is that since everything is compact, the constant is finite.
Yes. So you would expect that there is a large number of ground state and in equivalent. That could be an option. I don't know. We can come back to this question when I write the expression for the index, so you will see how it's constructed. Okay. So the boundary is time times Riemann surface. I will go to the Euclidean, and I was discussing yesterday, I will compactify time on a circle of radius beta. Because what I want to compute is something like this. I want to compute, as I was discussing yesterday, a grand canonical partition function, which means that will be a trace with minus 1 to the f, the Hamiltonian of the theory, and there will be a charge dual. This is the operator associated to the electric charge, multiplied by a chemical potential. Because remember, the black holes are the ionic, are both magnetic charges and electric charges. Magnetic charges define the theory you are considering. So this is really not just the conformal field theory. There is this twist, and I will discuss in a moment. This twist depends on the choice of magnetic charges. So I put the magnetic charges here. The electric charges, you need to count states with given electric charge. You introduce the electric charges with a dual chemical potential. Okay? So the picture is that the magnetic charge is an explicit parameter. The electric charge enters through a chemical potential. And this is just the partition function, the supersymmetric partition function on S1 times Sg. Now, I need to tell you how to compute through localization. I will not give you all the details. The story is always like in Francesco lecture, but I will tell you the structure of this partition function, and I'll give you some interpretation of it. Actually, this partition function can be computed in many different ways. So for example, you can find already, you need to read very carefully the paper, but you can find already in papers by Nekrasov and Shatashvili using this gauge beta correspondence. So they can reconstruct this function here, and you can compute using localization. I will give you the result based on localization because, as I show you, contains also the other. Obviously, the result is the same, so in some sense, it contains both. Okay, so let's, in the last 10 minutes, set up the problem. This is what I want to compute, essentially, a partition function on S1 times sigma g, but remember, sigma g is topologically twisted by the charges, okay? So let's see what this means. And we start with a general n equal to 2 theory in 3D. Tomorrow we will specialize to a BJM. And let me remember you what are the supersymmetry multiplet. There is a vector supersymmetry multiplet which contains gauge field, fermions, a real scalar, and the real auxiliary field, D. You can get this vector multiplet by a dimensional reduction of n equal 1 supersymmetry in 4D. You know that there is a mu, lambda, and D, that's the content. You reduce on a circle, the component of the gauge field along the circle become this sigma, okay? So this is the dimensional reduction of n equal 1 in 4 dimension. And the other interesting multiplet is the chiral multiplet, which is again the dimensional reduction of a chiral multiplet of n equal 1 supersymmetry in 4 dimension. Here there is nothing that you get in addition because you don't have any vector, so it's just complex scalar, fermion, and complex auxiliary field. All these fermions here now are Dirac fermions in Lorentzian signature, Dirac spinors. And as usual in Euclidean, you have to double everything and so on. So it's important to have a theory with an R symmetry. So forgive me for my unconventional notation. These are the notation we use in the paper, and I was too lazy to change consistently everywhere. So I'm giving charge minus 1 to the lambda. OK, just a choice, nothing particularly important. And it will not play a particular role here. So suppose that you have an R symmetry where the Gugino transform and the matter fields also transform. If the scalar transform with a charge, the fermion transform with the same charge minus 1. It will be important for quantization condition. I need to consider theories where you have an integer R symmetry, so the charges of your fields can be integer. Essentially because you want to put the theory on a sphere, on a Riemann surface, and the charge will be a charge on the Riemann surface, and you need to quantize it to have a consistent theory. So you need a line well-defined line bundle associated to the R symmetry charge. So the background that I want to turn on, let me do it first for S2 times S1. Yes. Oh, I could start with n equals 6, but usually in localization you just use a supercharge. And when you do localization, you just need a multiplet in your theory. The superpotential is not relevant. So when you do localization, you typically take the minimal amount of supersymmetry, you compute the one loop determinant for vector, and so on. So this is slightly more general. But for application to the black hole I was discussing before, you could have started with bigger supersymmetry, but at the end of the story, you choose one component of Q to do localization. So it's enough to start with n equal to 2, and this is more general. And also, when I will discuss ABJM, I will discuss ABJM in n equal to 2 notation, so everything will be well-suited with this parametrization. So the background. So the metric is the metric on S2 times S1. So let me take a flat metric on S2. Actually, you can take a more general one. I'm not doing that, but this is a topological twist. If you know a little bit about topological theories, means that they are independent of the metric that you put on the manifold. So if you start with something different, you will get precisely the same formula. And then there is a circle of radius beta. Okay? This is the metric. And once I chose the R symmetry here, I'm turning on a background field for the R symmetry, which is just a unit, minus one unit monopole, depends. Okay. It's essentially a unit monopole with some assignment of charges. And this is needed to solve the equation of supersymmetry. Indeed, the picture on the boundary is precisely the same as the picture in the bulk. So as Francesco explained, clearly, for example, in the Festuccia-Cyber approach, if you want to preserve supersymmetry, you say, OK, I take my field here, I couple to some supergravity, I freeze the fields in the supergravity multiplier to that particular value, and I need to check that the variation of the supersymmetry condition, in particular for the gravitino, which is the background field, are satisfied. But the variation for the gravitino, well, essentially, in this game are precisely the same that I wrote in the bulk. The only thing that I'm turning on is the metric and the R-symmetry. So the transformation of the gravitino when you couple to supergravity is precisely the same expression, gamma AB. Let me write in this way now. I will tell you also the convention for the gamma. And there is A mu R. So let's take, we are in three dimensions, so in the Euclidean, so we can just safely choose the gamma, the three gamma to be the Pauli matrices, okay? The three Pauli matrices. So if you, for example, so you need to say what is the charge of the epsilon under the R symmetry, I conventionally give charge minus one to epsilon. I put a plus instead of a minus here. And so you can see that this equation, now you can do your exercise. You compute a spin connection on the sphere. It's very simple. You plug in here everything, and you will get something of this form. Clearly, here you get essentially take the index 1 and 2 along the two sphere, index of frame, and index 3 along the circle. This will become something like mu. This, here you have gamma 1, gamma 2, that is I times sigma 3, epsilon. And here you just have I, A mu, R, epsilon. Now, A mu is this guy here. You compute your spin connection, and you discover, as I already told you yesterday, it's pretty obvious. There is not so much on a sphere. When you compute the spin connection, you get, again, the monopole. Actually, the monopole with charge 2. So that you see that if there is a sigma 3 here, it's enough to choose an eigenvalue of sigma 3. So if you choose a spinor which has zero component on the bottom and is a generic spinor epsilon plus here, this cancels precisely this one with this particular choice of sign. And as I was mentioning yesterday, you're just left with the condition that the mu epsilon equal to 0, so that you can take a constant. This time we are really on the boundary, and this is constant on the sphere, on the Riemann surface, on time, is a constant spinor. And this is, if you look at all literature, just the topological twist in the sense of Witten. You twist the nature of the spinor, you transform it essentially in a sort of scalar. The mu epsilon is the natural equation for a scalar. And the same trick works for arbitrary Riemann surfaces on sigma g. You just choose your gauge field such that it cancels the spin connection. So with this normalization, you take minus twice whatever you get from the spin connection is a U1 gauge field. You turn on the mu. Now using all the literature, topological twist, neuter method, Festuccia-Cyber, whatever you want, you can write the Lagrangian. I will show you the Lagrangian, and then we stop with this. Okay, the Lagrangian again is long, so I decide to write on a slide. Okay, good. This is the Lagrangian and supersymmetry transformation, just to give you an idea that there is a Lagrangian. I will not use much, but there is a Lagrangian, there are supersymmetry transformation, you can check everything. And look at the Lagrangian, it's pretty boring, actually. So on top there is the, can you see it, or should I enlarge? It's okay? Okay. Better? Okay, let's start with the first line. F mu square, boring. Kinetic term for the scalar field, boring. D square, you know that there is a D square, right? It's Jan-Mills. Dirac term. And a coupling between sigma and lambda-lambda, okay? But it's there also in flat space. Then there is another object that I will need, a BJM. I will tell you what it is in more details later, but contains Chern-Simon terms. This is the supersymmetric Chern-Simons in 3D. This is standard Chern-Simons. And you see that supersymmetry give you a sort of mass for the Gaginos and the coupling between D and sigma. And let me make it slightly smaller to in order that you can also see the matter Lagrangian. If you have an arbitrary chiral field, here I wrote just a field couple to gauge, but it can be an arbitrary representation. Again, there is a kinetic term, there is the F term, there is the Dirac equation, there are standard Yukawa coupling. The only thing that I want to mention, the only thing that the twist does is essentially coupling these Ws is, sorry, in this notation is the curvature of the A mu, so it's the R symmetry curvature, it enters here. And then there is D phi phi dagger. This, you know, is standard in supersymmetry, is how the D term couples to the phi. But the thing that I want to mention is the following. Look at sigma. Sigma is the real scalar in the vector multiplet. Look at how it appears in the matter Lagrangian. It gives a mass to the scalars, and it gives a mass to the fermion. Indeed, this sigma played the role of a real, what is called a real mass in 3D. That's a general picture. So masses in supersymmetric theories, if you have enough supersymmetry, you can introduce it by as background fields for some background gauge symmetry. So suppose that your gauge field is not really gauge, the coupling is zero, so there is no kinetic term. It becomes a background field. You can give a value to the various fields in the background, like in Festuccia Cyber. And if you do this game for a global symmetry, and you turn off the coupling, so to make global, but you keep a non-zero value for sigma, what you get is that it's the same theory as before with a real mass for the scalar. So sigma, remember, is a real mass. And you see that pretty much is looks like the Lagrangian in flat space. There is not so much. Topological twist is boring, as I was mentioning before. It's interesting, it's just transform the spinor in scalars, but it doesn't match to the Lagrangian. In particular, there is no curvature coupling, so the radius of the sphere, the radius of this one, are mostly relevant in this game. And just to conclude, let me also show for completeness the variation of fermions. These are written here. They are not particularly illuminating. The only thing that I want to mention is that remember that now you see lambda, lambda dagger, but you need to, in Euclidean, to consider these guys as independent. You see phi dagger, they are independent. Then when you do the path integral, you need to choose a real section, but here are essentially independent. And also epsilon, you have epsilon and epsilon tilde, so you can construct a Q and Q tilde. And pretty much they act on the field like in a sort of holomorphic way, right? So look at Q acting on the fermion. So Q acts on lambda, but gives zero on lambda dagger. So acts on half of the field, so the holomorphic part. Q tilde does the opposite, okay? That's a typical feature of topological twist of many theory in Euclidean signature. Okay. So tomorrow, here I stop, and tomorrow I will tell you how you localize. That's pretty simple. We will see that essentially, this I can already tell you briefly, the matter Lagrangian and the Jan-Mills Lagrangian are Q-exact, so they will go away. You will get a classical piece from the Chern-Simons, and then you will have a one-loop determinant to compute that. And I will discuss the one-loop determinant tomorrow morning as the first thing.